So, hello everyone. We are now going to look at how we can play double fianchetto when our opponents are playing the Slav defense. And we want to avoid main lines, so we are going for rate opening, and after knight f3, d5, we go g3 or c4, and our opponent is going c6. Most Slav players will do so, and then after g3, knight f6, bishop d2. I will discuss my game against Timman in another video, which when d takes c4 here, and this is a very important line to know. But in this video, we are going to look at a more solid line that Black can play, bishop f5, and then after, let's say, a couple of moves, castle e6, b3, bishop e7, d3, h6 is usually played, so just to preserve the bishop on f5, as it can easily be hit by the knight. So, bishop b2, knight d7, knight d2, castle, and this is a very typical position which I will discuss the plans for white and black, and I will do so with as an exemplary game. I will take the nice win of Richard Rapport over Magnus Carlsen in the Wackensee tournament in 2017. But they reach this position, this exact position, via completely different move order. Let's go to the game. Knight f3, d5, and Rapport was, when he was really young, just experimenting a lot with 1b3, and well, in this game he chose 2b3, at least to stop the move e5. This is important for us to understand that we go knight f3 to stop e5. So after d3, what is the most critical move? I think is e5, and that's why I think it's important. This is improvement already. Knight f3, d5, and then now b3. Carlsen responds with bishop f5, bishop b2, e6, d3, and now a6 already. Giving the bishop a retreating square to h7. So knight e2, knight f6, c4, and c6, g3, bishop e7, bishop d2, castle, castle, knight d7. And here Rapport went a3, because white's chances are on the queen side, and white is looking for queen side expansion with b4, and then white could go queen b3 and rook c1. So black's response to a3, you guessed it right, is a5, stopping b4. It's by far the best move, I think. Let's have a look at what happens if black plays some other move. Let's say bishop a7. We're really happy to go here b4, a5. And now queen b3, when white's position is already slightly better, I believe. a4, is this a problem for us? I don't believe it. We go queen c3, and yeah, this pawn a4 might later turn out to be just a weakness. And white still has this also interesting break in the center with e4, which he can prepare. So no, white has a space advantage, and that's a good pieces. Our fianchettoed bishops can become very strong here. So a3, it's very natural to stop white's plan by going a5. But we still want to play the move b4, so how should we prepare that? Well, we have several options for that. You could think of playing bishop c3. Somehow people do not really do that. In the game, Rapport shows queen b1, later more on that. But another important idea for white here is to go either rook a2 or rook c1. So rook a2, this is something we have already discussed a bit in the first video on the game Reti against Yates. So white has this setup with rook a2, queen a1, followed by rook b1. And it's very interesting. White will then try to play the next bishop c3 and then go b4. It does look a bit strange to play rook a2 here, but it's definitely worth a try, and you will look really cultured if you do so. So queen b1 was a move chosen in the game, and it's the plan is very similar. White wants to go now bishop c3, queen b2, maybe rook b1 if necessary, and then go b4. So it's slightly different, and I guess Rapport believes that this setup is more promising. Now bishop a7 was played. That's a useful move since the bishop is going to be attacked sooner or later, so better to sidestep that. For example, it's easy to make some blunder if you, let's say, go b5, which is a move which you sometimes see. Then now the pawn on c6 is undefended, and here there would be knight d4, and black's position is already collapsing. So bishop a7 is a good move. Now white goes b4 without any further preparation, since that's not really necessary. White is not blundering upon him. Let us have a look what happens if we take on b4, as happened in the game, by the way. A take b4, and now bishop take b4. Did we lose a pawn? No, the bishop on b4 is hanging, and we can play here bishop take f6. And after, let's say, queen f6, we shouldn't forget to take on a8. Not like that. Here. Rook a8, and now queen b4, and white is a piece up. So the pawn on b4 cannot be captured, so black castles at queen b6 here. So bishop c3, defending the pawn on b4, rook take a1, and the game is quite forcing. Queen take a1, and now bishop take b4. So bishop take b4, queen b4, and now white regains the pawn with rook b1, queen d6, and rook take b7. And all this had to be calculated by Carlsen when he went for this rook take a1 on move 14, and he also had to calculate the next move, e5. Since if he doesn't go e5 here, then white is just very pleasantly better here, because white's pawn structure is more healthy, and white has the rook already on the 7th rank. It is also controlling the a file, and you could argue that this bishop on h7, occasionally could be just a spectator. So this is the kind of position that easily could get from this opening. If your opponent plays passively here, then you really enjoy some advantage and have good chances to win. But of course Carlsen knows what to do, and he knows how to find this counterplay. He went for e5, and that seems right. The bishop on h7 is not working, so with this move black creates the option of going e5, e4, and that would activate a lot of the black pieces. So just seems to be position is quite balanced at this moment. Here white has a choice whether to take on d5, yes or no. I think what Rapport did is better. He decided not to take on d5. Let's see what is the downside of c take d5. Well, it's clearly not knight take d5, because that is just a bad pawn structure. C6 is already a bad pawn. but now also white plays knight c4 and the pawn e5 is lost. So after cd5, black should recapture the pawn. This is of course very natural. Usually it's very good to have such a nice pawn center. But here white of course has an idea. It's to go bishop h3. And even though black has this pawn center, like very similar by the way to what happened in Reti against Yates, white does have play against this center. White is putting pressure on e5 with the help of the queen and the knight, and both e4 and d4 do not look very promising. However, black should go e4, I believe, because now after, let's say, d take e4, white can play knight e4 here, but here black can play the move e3. This, I think, is a very good move. White takes it, and then after knight c5, white is now a pawn up, but it's not the most useful pawn. It's a doubled pawn. And also, white's king on g1 looks now not that great. So here black just has equal chances, I would say. So after all, the pawn is a pawn, but not much to worry here for black. Black also really has nice control of this e4 square. So yeah, this is very playable for black. Therefore, better to play d4 and keep the c pawns on the board. Then now after e4, then white will play knight e5. And that knight is very strong on e5. It controls a lot of squares, but also you cannot easily get rid of it. It's not possible to take it, since after d take e5, both the queen and the knight on f6 are forced. So, yeah, the knight on e5 looks very annoying. So that's why e takes d4 was played. Knight takes d4. And, Carlsen continued to play ambitiously. He played the move c5 here. The knight went to b3. It's also possible to go to b5, but also the knight could be just hitting thin air, so to say. So knight b3, it keeps pressure at least on the pawn on c5. But at first sight, knight b5 looks way more logical. But it was not considered to be a good move by Laporte. And here black went for the move d4. So so now this means that white bishop is a very good piece, d4 does also cut off the queen on a1. It's not that great a diagonal anymore. D4 is a bit double-edged decision. It's possible to take d takes c4, and if Carlsen was satisfied with the draw, then probably this is what he should have done. Then white will take on c4, and now black has queen e6, attacking both the knight on c4 and the pawn on e2. Then knight e3, and now after bishop e4, bishop e4, knight e4, you get a position where it's probably around equal. It's difficult to say which side I would prefer to play here. If you can win this c pawn, then still what is left remaining is only 4-3 on the king side, and if many pieces come out off, then even that will lead to a draw. So looks like just draw is a huge favorite outcome here. But Carlsen was in a more fighting move and played the move d4. And bishop h3 was played here. So attacking the knight on d7, and now also we see that the knight on b3, it functions quite well here. Because if now a move like knight e5, then white will play something like queen a5. And both queen and knight are working very well together to attack the pawn on c5. Probably the decision by Carlsen was not very good. He played move d3 and probably better was to play rook b8. But already here, the position is equal, but not really equal, I think. So queen b8, queen a5, and now black needs to defend his pawn on c5, and the best way to do so is queen c8. But by doing so, you put your queen in, the knight in d7 is now pinned. So it's not the most comfortable square, and if any side has some kind of initiative here, it's white, so black has to defend the c5 pawn. I don't see an easy way to improve for white here, but queen b5 could be a move. And it would be nice if white could somehow get the knight on d2 also to a better square, but it's the kind of position that engines probably give as 0-0-0, but it is really a bit easier to play for the white side here. So that was a good decision, but I believe that Rapport had placed his bets on some trick which is in the position, and Rapport did not fall for that. White played e3, and this is very good. It's not so easy to allow this pawn on d3 to be a passed pawn, but I think Rapport evaluated quite well that the pawn on d3 is not a strong pass pawn. It's well blockaded by the knight on d2, and I think also the bishop on h7 just doesn't look very great at the moment. Carlsen went for some very concrete play with knight e5. This is not working very well. Of course, f4 is what white wants to play at the right moment, and this is maybe what Carlsen was hoping for. F4 should be very well prepared, and then it's good. If white can play f4 and followed by e4, then it's really great. But if white plays f4 immediately, black has a nice little trick. It's knight f3 check. And after we take, there's bishop e4. And now both the rook on b7 and the knight on f3 are hanging. If the rook moves, let's say to h7, bishop take f3. Now suddenly the bishop on f3 just became very good. White needs to blockade the d3 pawn, but it will also not be so easy to control the e4 square, which is now a big weakness in white position. So f4 would really be a mistake, but white just very calmly went bishop g2. And now it's not at all easy for black anymore, since white is going to play f4 next, or maybe even h3, f4, e4. And once these pawns come forward, then white has this pawn majority on the king side, which means that white has an extra pawn here. This is the situation here. So white, if white can advance those pawns there, that will become very threatening, and then black's knights will be pushed to bad squares, and white will get access to the d5 square for maybe the bishop. So it's a very strong plan white has now at his disposal. So bishop d2 was a very good move, and probably the best that black can do now is retreat the knight. But it turns out that the knight is not at all well placed on e5. So this was the best move, but instead Carlsen went for peace sacrifice. He played rook c8 and white played f4, so no preparatory move with h3, just immediately f4, knight e4, and now e4. And you see that the knights are getting chased away from their most natural squares, and e5 is now a threat. If you move the queen somewhere, let's say the eight, then so this is what can happen if you have many minor pieces on the board and white is advancing the king side majority, then your knights end up like this. We have already seen this before, actually, in the game Reti against Yates. Also there, Black's knights ended up on miserable squares, and this is very similar. Yeah, so this is the phase that Black's face if he plays incorrectly against this pawn majority that white has on the king side. So instead, Castle played here rook e8, and after e5 he sacrificed the piece with knight take e5, but after fe5 rook e5, yeah, you could argue that white's king is still a little bit weak, but Rapport played just very accurately. He played the move rook b6, and of course if black takes on d6, then white takes on e5, and with one more piece exchanged, it's now clear that black is lacking the potential to really do any damage to the white king. C5 is also under attack, and also black has to worry about back rank mates with the king on g8 and the bishop on h7, so this doesn't work out for black at all. So queen e7 was played to keep as many pieces on the board, but then now after rook b8 check, knight e8, Rapport found a really nice way to finish the game with bishop c6. You might at first think that this is a blunder, but after rook e1, Rapport just takes it, and after knight f1, black resigns because there's nothing that he can do about rook take e8. And okay, the only way to avoid losing material is king f8, but then white will take on c5, for example, and this is quite a hopeless endgame for black. So yeah, Carlsen resigned here. So what can we say about this game, which was of course a very good win for Rapport? It was mainly won because Carlsen became too ambitious, but we also see that white has a very nice plan, and with b4 here, and although the opening it was not giving white really any advantage, I think there are more patient ways, I think, to play this position. So white can also wait with b4 for just a little bit and play for example bishop c3 first, and it's a bit more slow, and but I like this idea of queen b2, rook b1, then go b4 a bit later. The way things went, there were a lot of exchanges, and this position is looks promising for white at first, but black has this move e5 e4 and gets counterplay. So Carlsen got his counterplay but wanted too much and then lost the game.